Thank you, Michael, and welcome to worship at Peace Lutheran Church in Peoria, Arizona, on this day in which we celebrate the baptism of Jesus and begin the season of Epiphany. Epiphany means manifestation, and so it is during this season that we will look for how God manifests himself in Christ Jesus. And of course, we celebrate that God manifests himself in the church and in the body of Christ, including the individual members of the body of Christ, the priesthood of all believers. And so as we celebrate worship this day, we hope that you will set aside elements in your home and participate alongside us as we honor the Christ who comes to us in the meal where we share in bread and in drink. Just a couple of announcements. First of all, again, to say thank you for your faithfulness throughout this past year as we continue to worship both here online, and we also offer worship outdoors at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings, where we maintain social distance as well as ask you to wear a mask and go through a protocol by which we register you. But we also want to encourage you to go to www.peaceaz.org and to check out all the offerings that we have online. And if you have yet to Zoom, perhaps that can be your New Year's resolution, to join in one of our Zoom groups that gathers throughout the week. With that, however, let us begin our worship. And Michael, will you lead us in song?
Time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come, come, just as you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, with joy and with awe, we praise you for claiming us as your sons and daughters, and for the pouring out of your Holy Spirit upon us. Help us to prepare this earth for your glory and shine your light on all your faithful children for the sake of the one whose birth and baptism brought renewal and transformation to our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We will continue with the reading of God's Word.
The lesson is from the book of Psalms. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. O create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, you who are God my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise. Here ends the lesson.
The Holy Gospel, appointed for this day in which we celebrate the baptism of Jesus, is from the Gospel of St. Luke, the third chapter. We read in Jesus' name. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod Tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip Tetrarch of Ituria and Trachonitis, and Licinius Tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." Every valley will be filled, and every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough way smooth. And all people will see God's salvation. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the tree, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowds asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. and anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you are required, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. But when John rebuked Herod the Tetrarch because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the other evil things he had done, Herod asked this to them all. He locked John up in prison. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened. And the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, you are my son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased. This is the gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Grace and peace be with us all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. If there was ever a time that we needed to hear God's word, this is it. Not some word simply printed on a page, not some wise teachings or sayings from the past, but we proclaim that God's word is alive, that it is God's living address to us in this moment. And in this moment, as we read from the third chapter of Luke's gospel, we hear God saying to us, this is the time to repent. Now, I know that today is set aside to celebrate the baptism of our Lord, but when we look at the passage that was appointed for this day, the focus is clearly upon John the Baptist. After taking a few sentences to describe the historical setting in which his ministry begins, Luke gets right to the point and describes to us what John's work and his mission must be, that there in the countryside around the River Jordan, that he is to preach a baptism of repentance and of forgiveness of sins. Now, we don't want to forget forgiveness, and we'll get there, but we want to start with this word, repentance. And the Greek word for repentance is metanoia, which loosely is translated to be a change of mind or a change of heart. If we push it just a little bit more, it really means more of a transformation, like the transformation of a caterpillar into a butterfly. But if I were to give you an illustration that perhaps captures this word repentance to its fullest extent, I would have to use the words turnaround. Imagine that we get into our car, we're driving down the road, and we come upon a sign that says, bridge out. Now, the wise choice would be to turn around and find an alternative path, because to continue on that path is probably going to lead to some consequences which are not going to make us happy. And so that's exactly what John the Baptist is offering to the crowds that come to him. To turn around from a life and a path that is leading to your destruction, and instead turn towards the God of your salvation. Now, over the last week, let's be honest, over the last year, over the last dozen of years, we recognize that we need to make some changes. We're not just talking about spirituality, because we understand as we read through the Gospels that spiritual matters intersect with worldly matters. In fact, as the crowd comes to John the Baptist, he asks of them, he commands them to produce fruit worthy of repentance. So we need to acknowledge. We need to acknowledge that our distrust of institutions and of one another is poisoning civil dialogue in our nation. We need to acknowledge. We need to acknowledge that our rampant individualism is leading to selfishness, which is corrupting our civil exchange. We need to acknowledge. We need to acknowledge that capitalism on steroids is destroying the life and the dignity of our neighbors. We need to acknowledge, do we not, that here in the United States, as we experience the ravages of this pandemic, and we acknowledge that we have the highest rate of infection from around the world, and that our hospitals are filled to capacity, that this is not an act of God, but this is on us, and that we need to repent of our rebellion against God and our rebellion against one another. That this calls for more than just a change of our ways, but this really calls for a change of heart, does it not? We need to recognize, do we not, that we who live in the longest-lasting democracy, the oldest democracy in our world, who are now being pitied by our friends and foes alike, that this is not a failure of democracy, but this is a failure of Democrats and Republicans to accept and to acknowledge and to abide by democratic principles. We need more than just a change of rhetoric, more than just a change in tone of speech. No, we need a change of heart. And we need to acknowledge that those who are struggling to get by, that those who cannot seem to make it, for those who seem as if the world has piled upon them and they have no opportunity for success, that this is not a result of a welfare state, but that this is a result of a failure on our part to look out for the welfare of one another. And this requires of us more than just a change in policy. This requires of us a change of heart. Now, I'll be the first to admit that a change of heart does not come easily. Does not come easily. One of my favorite authors is C.S. Lewis. And in his Chronicles of Narnia, which are children tales that tell of really adult themes, in the book titled The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, he talks about a group that is engaged on an epic quest. Indeed, a noble quest, you might say. But there is one in the crew, his name is Eustace, who is lacking in nobility. He is a cantankerous know-it-all who is unwilling to share in the burdens of duties for this journey. Now, the story goes that there's a great storm and the ship is indeed battered, and so they need to make port in order to make repairs, and so they find this uncharted island. And of course, what Eustace does is he separates himself from the rest to avoid any responsibility or any form of work. And he finds his way out into the midst of the island, and he discovers a cache of gold and of jewels. And of course, his greed gets the better of him. And to make a long story short, what happens is that he has discovered a dragon's lair. And by taking these unto himself, he himself becomes a dragon. Now, an interesting transformation takes place at this point. Eustace the dragon recognizes what a drag he has been upon the spirit and the morale of the rest of the crew. And once he is able to convince them of who he is able to offer them and to cooperate with them in the repairs that are needed so that they can continue on their journey. But of course, there is this foreboding that weighs over him as well as his companions, because they all recognize that there's no room on the ship for a fully grown dragon. Eustace despairs. This is where Aslan, the lion, the Christ figure, enters into the story. And Aslan comes to Eustace and commands him to scrape at his scales, to remove the barnacles that encrust himself. But each time that Eustace scrapes at the scales and removes these from his body, of course, there is just another layer underneath. He continues to try again and again and again, and again he falls into despair and discouragement. And this is when Aslan comes to him again and says, "You must allow me to do this." And Eustace, describing the moment, says that Aslan comes to him with razor sharp claws and cuts through the scales to his very heart. It hurt more than anything ever in his life. And as he peels away the scales, he then takes Eustace and this frail body and tosses him into the pond, and emerges out of that Eustace, the boy. Not the same boy he once was, a much changed boy. In baptism, God promises us that he will not allow us to be encrusted by the scales of our sins. But this is God's work and not ours. Indeed, this is not simply something that happens once and we are done, but that God sends his Holy Spirit to us to work in us and to reveal to us the power of forgiveness. As Martin Luther, the founder of our tradition, would say, "Daily I die to my sinful nature, and daily I am reborn again in the promise of my baptism." So yes, we need to acknowledge that we need to repent. Our nation needs to repent. Our church needs to repent. But in repenting, let us adopt and acknowledge our identity as the beloved children of God, that God has indeed made us new through the promise of baptism. And rather than seeking to blame the other, let us indeed reconcile with our brothers and sisters. And as we are able to express our love for God, may they also see in that expression a love for others as ourselves. May this be our New Year goal. May this be our mission. May this be our purpose. Let us pray. Gracious, gentle, generous God, you will not allow us to live in our sins, but you will renew us and rebirth us in the promise of your grace. So in the midst of the strife and the scorn of this troubled world, help us to be signs of your light, your love, and your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Michael, will you lead us in song?
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Gathered together as God's people in Christ Jesus, let us pray for God's creation, those in need, and all of the church. Renewing God, we thank you for the gift of baptism. Give your church boldness to proclaim your promises. Tear down obstacles of injustice so that your word of hope reaches the ends of the earth. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Almighty God, we rejoice in your authority as Prince of Peace. Deliver us from those who wield power through unjust and oppressive ways. Raise up prophets to speak your truth in this and every nation. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Gracious God, we seek healing for all people who long for justice, freedom, and comfort. Sustain them in their time of need. Be with all who wait for you, who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Peaceful God, we give thanks for those who are ready to help in times of crisis. Give courage to disaster and emergency response teams, police officers, nurses, doctors, surgeons, chaplains, and all who work for the sake of others. Hear us, O God, for your mercy is great. Merciful God, with the mayhem and lawlessness of Tuesday still fresh in our memories, we join with the bishops of Region 2 and pray for an end to the political rancor that has divided us as a nation. We pray also for those who feel that their voices are not being heard and ask that concerns and problems be achieved by productive and peaceful means. We pray for the willingness of our leaders to work with all those who have been called to serve with the great hope that Christ will reign in our hearts. May we be washed in the waters of reconciliation and empowered to be the instruments of your peace. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Again, thank you for your generous sharing of your gifts with the community of peace and for the mission and ministry that we bring to this world. Just this last week, our youth and children's ministry were able to deliver over 120 blessing bags to different members of our congregation as we provide instruction for our families. That's because of you and your generosity. So thank you. Let us continue now with our prayer of thanksgiving. Merciful God, to you all glory, honor, and praise belong, now and forever. Accept our gifts as a token of our love for you and for the world that you have crafted. Use our gifts as a means by which good news is shared, sight is given, and liberty is offered to all. May we experience a renewed freedom in Christ as we too share in the promise of God's good gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And indeed, the best of all gifts that God gives to us is the gift of Himself as we celebrate the promise of Holy Communion. For on the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, He took bread and He gave thanks to His Father in heaven. He then broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, He took a cup of wine, and again He gave thanks. And He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Now I invite you to join with me as we share in the prayer that Jesus first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And so we welcome you to set aside elements in your home and to share in this meal and promise of Christ's presence as Michael will lead us with song. Michael?
On holy ground, on holy
And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us, keep us in his light, his love, keep us on a path of peace this day and always. Amen.
Let us pray. We have feasted upon this meal of grace. We have been renewed by the spirit of the new wine you have served us this day. Now let the light of your gospel scatter the darkness as we are sent out as a reflection, your enduring love. All this we ask in the name of our Savior Jesus, who revealed himself in Galilee. Amen.
Amen. And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are glad to have had this time of worship with you. We will close with song. Michael?
Send us out in the power of the Spirit to shine your light in the way we live. Send us out in the power of the Spirit as we received, may we freely give. Send us out.
Now let our light so shine before others that all might give glory to our Father in heaven. Amen. We love you, but most importantly, God loves you. Have a blessed week. We hope to see you next week. Amen.